Hey guys, Michael Kummer here from michaelkummer.com, and today I would like to talk about cheese and whether or not cheese is good or bad for you. And I look at cheese from an angle of both the paleolithic as well as the ketogenic diet, because I'm on a ketogenic paleo diet, which combines both of these diets into one. And funny enough, cheese is not paleo, and we'll get into why that is, but cheese is very popular on keto, and keto is arguably a healthy diet. So what gives? Is cheese healthy or is it unhealthy? To answer that question, we really have to understand a little better the components or the macronutrients and types of macronutrients that make up cheese. And there are obviously three macronutrients: there's protein, there is carbohydrates, and there is fat. And certain cheeses have different types of these proteins and fats, and it's important to distinguish in order to determine if cheese is healthy or not healthy for you. From an evolutionary perspective, humans did not consume any significant amounts of dairy, including cheese, up until about 10,000 years ago. That's when humans started farming, domesticating animals, and drinking their milk and making products out of that milk, like cheese, for example. So for a period of 2.6 million years before we started farming, humans did not consume any significant amounts of dairy. And so you could argue that the human body has not necessarily evolved to consume milk, other than breast milk, of course. And that's why cheese is not paleo-friendly. If you're on a paleo diet, then technically you're not supposed to eat cheese. Many people like cheese, including me. And on the flip side, cheese is very popular because of its high fat content generally on the ketogenic diet. Let's take apart the three macronutrients and let's try to figure out if cheese is healthy or not, and what type of cheese is potentially better for your health than others. And let's start with protein. And dairy in general have generally two types of protein. One is whey. You might recognize that from whey protein powder if you're working out. Very popular protein, source of protein, because it's easily digestible and the body can absorb it incredibly quick. So many people use protein shakes as a post-workout meal, etc. And the second major protein in dairy is casein. And there are two types of casein. Regular milk, especially regular cow's milk, has both of those types. Casein beta A1 and casein beta A2. And there is a debate going on, and there is scientific evidence to suggest that the casein beta A1, which is what you find in traditional cow's milk predominantly, is inflammatory. So it can cause inflammation in your body. And inflammation is one of the contributing factors, if sustained over a long period of time, if we talk about systemic inflammation, that can cause to the development of metabolic diseases such as cardiovascular disease, stroke, cancer, etc. So you want to avoid inflammatory foods. Now, there are certain types of cows that produce milk with casein beta A2, but you find that milk very readily in your local grocery store. And I've yet to find cheese here at the local Whole Foods market in Georgia, in the Atlanta area, that is made from A2 cows. It's not very popular. It exists, but you really have to look and find those. So the good news is there are certain animals that produce A2 milk, and that includes sheep, goat, and camel, for example. So if you buy cheese from either of those three, then you get the potentially less inflammatory protein, which, especially if you consume a lot of cheese, might be much better for your health in the long run. The second factor to look at is carbohydrates, and in particular the milk sugar or lactose. Regular milk has lactose, milk sugar, and the problem with lactose is that two-thirds of adults worldwide lack the enzyme to metabolize that lactose. That enzyme is called lactase with an A. Every baby, every newborn has that enzyme because breast milk contains lactose as well. As we start weaning the baby from the breast, the body stops producing lactase because it's not required anymore. Nature didn't intend for us to continue with cow's milk after being weaned from the breast. And so most adults don't have sufficient lactase to completely metabolize lactose in dairy, which is why, you know, there are some people who are lactose intolerant. I mean, if they drink milk, they have to go right to the bathroom. For others, it's more like, you know, feeling bloated, being gassy, etc. But for most adults, there is some sort of lactose sensitivity, even if you might not be aware of that, or even if you've been living with the symptoms because you think they're normal. They're not. And so the goodness is with cheese that the older the cheese is, the more it has aged, the less lactose it has. So if you buy cheese that has aged for 6 or 12 months or even longer, you will only find residual amounts of lactose, and it should be much easier for you to handle that cheese, or for your stomach to handle aged cheese rather than fresh cheese. And so that's the second component that I look at when buying cheese. I tend to stick with aged cheeses that have less or no lactose. And then the third component is fat. Now, that's really the primary reason why I buy cheese, besides the taste, that I like how it tastes. But it's a good source of fat. And the problem with fat is that it has a different chemical composition depending on how the animal was raised. So grain-fed animals, for example, grain-fed cows in particular, produce or have fat, and that translates into the milk then, that has a slightly different chemical composition than cows that were pasture-raised or grass-fed. And so that's why I always try to stick with pastured and grass-fed when it comes to meat, as well as when it comes to cheese. Then there is actually a fourth component that might not be as important for cheese as it is for milk, and that is whether or not the milk has been pasteurized, meaning heated. The reason why we pasteurize milk generally, and most states prevent or do not allow the sale of unpasteurized milk to the public, the reason for that is because heating the milk up, pasteurizing it, destroys microorganisms that may make you sick, right? So that's a good thing. The problem is whenever you process food and when you heat food, it does not only destroy the bad stuff, it destroys the good stuff as well. So enzymes and micronutrients that might be in the raw milk get destroyed when it's pasteurized. And then when you make cheese out of the pasteurized milk, you don't get all those nutrients that you could potentially get if the cheese was made from raw milk. And so the good news is, or the bad news is, many states prevent the sale of raw milk to the public, but raw cheeses are generally allowed because of the processing methods and other factors. There are significantly less risk that you get sick from raw cheese, because it's, you know, the aging and everything, it's a processing method at the end of the day as well. And so there is less risk of getting sick from that raw cheese. Now, you also won't find as many nutrients likely in raw cheese as you would find in raw milk. So it goes both ways, really. So how do I buy cheese? Well, when I go to Whole Foods, and that's where we buy most of our cheeses, I always ask for pastured, meaning grass-fed, goat or sheep, and aged. Unfortunately, that combination you will likely never find at Whole Foods. At least here in Georgia, I have not yet found that combination. So, you know, unless you have a source of your cheese that meets all of those specifications, you have to make trade-offs. So what I try is, if I typically go with goat or sheep that's aged. You find a couple of different options, like I have here this 12-month old Manchego cheese that's from pasteurized sheep's milk. And so it checks the aging component, so very little or no lactose, and it has the casein beta A2 from sheep, from the sheep's milk and not from cow's milk. The second one I have here is a goat product. It's called Midnight Moon. That's pretty good as well. I don't know how long it has aged, but it's pretty hard. So it has aged at least for a little bit. And then the third one that we occasionally buy is the grass-fed, grass-fed whatever cow's milk type of cheese. And so you get the wrong quote-unquote casein, unfortunately, but it's at least grass-fed, it's raw, so it checks off two of those other boxes, and that's typically the combination that we go with. So, you know, cheese, again, it's likely not the healthiest food you can eat, because our bodies from an evolutionary perspective are not accustomed to it. But if you want to have cheese, then I would stick with goat, sheep, camel, something that has casein beta A2. I would try something aged if you like the taste. And if you need to have cow's cheese, then I would go with pasteurized, a better source of fat, and something raw maybe. And that's pretty much it. That wraps it up with cheeses today. We're going to be talking about cold cuts and meats in the next video. And so stay tuned for that. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe and click the alert button so you get notified when I publish more videos like this.